Hi everyone. I've been looking forward to doing this series with you for some time now and excited that we can actually get into this book of Revelation today. We're going to go through it verse by verse, chapter by chapter. In this segment, I'd like to just kind of do an overview of what we're trying to accomplish and what this is about. We know from the book of Genesis that God describes the beginning of the earth. And so the book of Revelation describes the end of the earth. The book of Genesis describes the emergence of humanity and the spread of humanity. And so there has to be a closure to that. There has to be the end of the book, the end of the story. And the way to read the Bible is to see it as one big journey that starts in Genesis and goes to Revelation. So there, in all fairness to us, there has to be an end of the story. I read about a prank that someone had done on their friend. They had taken a mystery book that they were reading, some kind of novel on a vacation, and when they weren't looking, they took a scalpel and they cut out the last chapter of the book, where everything comes together and everything you've been reading and everything you've been, all the drama that you've been experiencing in the preceding chapters, now you come to the end of the book and there's no end. There's no closure. There's no finality to it. And that's what it would be like without the book of Revelation. It'd be awful not to have a complete picture and closure and a summary of how things wrap up. And so that's a good way to approach the book of Revelation. That's what it's for. That's why it's in the Bible. That's God's gift to us to be able to see how this ends. It's possible to read the book of Revelation and become afraid, to become stressed and troubled, kind of picturing yourself in this awful climatic book of the Bible. But I think that's a disadvantage. I don't think that's the way we're supposed to approach it. The way God explained it in the very beginning to John, he said, "Blessed are those who keep this prophecy, those who read this book and keep it." So there's a blessing in it. And that's what we have to mine out. That's what we're looking for. What was the blessing that God hid in this book that he's set aside for us? I think there'll be a time when we will look back and we'll see the justice of God. And down here, there's so very little justice. There's not a lot of good closure to the hardships that people go through. And so the book of Revelation also closes out with a summary of the justice of God. And for that reason, I think we need to understand the book. We need to get into it. We need to read it. We shouldn't be afraid of it. Even in Paul's day, people were teaching and prophesying things that made people afraid. And Paul wrote to the Thessalonians, and they're brand new Christians. They're just weeks and months old when he's writing to them. So it's very early in Christianity. And listen to this. Paul writes about the coming of the Lord, and this is 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. And he says, "Do not be soon shaken in mind, and troubled." And the word troubled here has to do with feeling pressure, feeling stress, either by spirit or by word or by letter. So either by prophecy or by teaching or some letter that is supposed to have been written by Paul or part of his team. And there's a prospect of being deceived. He said, "Don't let anyone deceive you by any means." And he goes on talking about the end times and how it actually works. So from day one, there's been this tendency to use the end times to scare people, to put pressure on them, to deceive them, to make them shaken in mind. And I don't think that's the heart of God. I don't think that's what he wants for us. And so that's not going to be how I approach this teaching. There's a lot in here that I don't know. I've been rereading and listening to it. On my phone, I can listen to the entire book in about an hour. And so I've been listening to it to get a kind of a big picture view. And I don't find it frightening. I find it fascinating. I find it stimulating, but I don't find it frightening, and I don't want you to be frightened by it. The word revelation basically means taking the lid off of something. And so this is God's gift to us. He's taken the lid off of history. He's taken the lid off of what's coming. And when we approach it that way, it helps us to understand that that's his intent. That's what he wants to do. He wants us to know what's coming. He doesn't want us to be surprised by what's coming. And at the same time, there's an element of mystery that even though he tells us what's coming, it's hard to figure out. And that's something that God has been doing from the very beginning. All through the Bible, he would have prophets prophesy, here's what's coming, but it was still a mystery. And I've been thinking a lot about that. I think we need, as people, I think we need that element of mystery, the not knowing. And so he discloses what's coming, but there's a part of it where you still can't quite figure out what he's saying. And I think that's to our advantage. I think that keeps us in the game. I think that keeps us engaged. I think that keeps us anticipating. And he doesn't want to rob us of that anticipation. I think that's very, very important. So prophets and pastors who tell you, I understand all the mysteries and I'm going to tell you who's who the players are, and what all the details are, I doubt God's going to reveal that to them. Because once you know, once you've got it all figured out, it takes something away from us. It takes something out of our heart that it causes us to coast or to relax too much. It's like this: if there's a big game tonight, and if someone you missed a game, you had to work, and someone called you and said, "Here's the outcome of the game. Here's the final score. Here's who won. Here's a description of the big plays of the game." It would take something out of your heart to want to watch it. So the mystery has been taken out of it. We call it a spoiler. And I've noticed lately that, you know, when they review a movie or a television series, they'll say on the front end, "Spoiler alert! We don't want to wreck this for you. We're going to tell you some details that could rob you of the anticipation of watching the movie or watching the series." I think it's the same with the book of Revelation. I don't think God's going to tell us and explain all the details because it will rob us of that anticipation, which he wants us. He wants us to be on alert. He wants us to be looking forward. He wants us to be in the game completely. And so to explain every detail so there's nothing to look forward to, I think that'd be a ripoff more than an advantage. There are people who write books explaining all the detail of how it all works and how the book of Revelation works. I'm not going to do that. Here's one that came out. I remember when this came out. This is 88 reasons why the rapture will happen in 1988. And the man was selling these books, and he had an end time theory on the back of it as well. I remember when this happened, and of course Jesus didn't come back in 1988, and the man was selling the book, but he goes on. I mean, he says, "I could not have made this up. This discloses so many details that my imagination could not have made this up," but he did. And Jesus didn't come back, but he had all the solutions. He had it all figured out. Here's another one that came out. I remember when this came out in 2000, why Jesus is coming back in the year 2000. And he actually puts a date in here. He does it. This is a big fat book of all the summary of what it all means and who all the players are and what every mystery, he solves every mystery. And he even put a guarantee on this book that if it didn't come to pass in 2000, I forget the actual date that he gave here now, you got your money back. And so he was doing it with some integrity. The other man, he's selling a book about the end times saying Jesus is coming back. Why would you sell the book? What are you gonna do with the money when he comes back on that date? So what I wanna do is use a bigger brush, paint with a bigger brush. I'm not going to fill in all the details for you. I don't want you to be trying to figure out who's who and how this all plays out and when this all happens. I think we'll miss some of the ingredients that our heart needs these days. Here's what I'm shooting for. Here's what I want you to get. I'll tell you from the beginning what my intention is. I really want you to get a sense of awe of how big God is and how much he's in control. He's written the end from the beginning, so there's no surprises to him. Heaven is filled with peace. It's filled with worship. No matter what's going on the earth, things are progressing in heaven. He's completely in control. He knows all things. He anticipates all things. There's no surprises for him. He allows things to happen, which shows how big he is, how mighty he is. I think these days, especially when it looks like sometimes our government is doing crazy things, when it feels like people are having political advantage over us, when it feels like things are happening to us and we have no control over it, I think we need a sense that God is big and that he's in control. And I want you to come away with that from looking at the book of Revelation. I also want you to see how much worship is happening in these end times. It's almost like a split screen, if you think of it this way, that there's this track of everything that's going on in the earth, and then there's a split screen that shows everything that's going on in heaven, and heaven's full of worship. People are falling down before the Lord and worshiping him and full of gratitude. If you think of it as a split screen and we approach it that way, I think that's what we should be doing down here, that if that's what's happening in heaven, let's link up with that. Let's make sure our response to whatever's happening in the earth is worshipful, is filled with gratitude. We will be in sync with what's going on in heaven if we're going to worship no matter what. And I think that's the right posture. The book of Revelation is filled with worship. I can't think of another book of the Bible that has as much worship demonstrated and expressed in it than what I see in the book of Revelation. I'm hoping that when we come out of it, we will be more full-hearted worshipers, aligned with what's going on in heaven more than we're aligned with what's going on in the earth. I'd like to also say that there are about 50 prophecies. I forget the exact number. It's been a while since I looked it up. About Jesus' first coming. And people studied them. They knew certain things. The prophets would talk about being born in Bethlehem, being raised in Nazareth, and a flight to Egypt. And it described his first coming. It described all of his suffering. It described a lot about his ministry and his message. But as people anticipated the coming of the Messiah, the coming of Jesus, they missed it. So that when he actually did come, the scholars, the people who were searching for him with real diligence and maybe he had a reputation for knowing everything about the Messiah and where he's going to come from and trying to figure out when he's going to come, for the most part, they missed it. And even when they watched it unfold in front of them, without Jesus giving commentary and Jesus helping them understand that this verse here is really talking about John the Baptist, without him doing that, I don't know that we would have taken that verse and realized he's talking about the one who come prepare the way for him. And Jesus filled in the blanks and helped them to understand this is what this means. And without that, in the moment, or at the end when he looks back and he explains everything about the kingdom, I don't think we would have paired up all those verses with all those circumstances. I remember reading in John's gospel, Zechariah had prophesied that Jesus would come on this colt that had never been ridden, and he'd come into Jerusalem as a triumphant king. And John is so astonished that he participated in prophecy, that he said, we set him on the donkey. We set him, we got the colt and we put him on it. It's almost like he's so surprised that he didn't know at the moment, he didn't know at the time that he was actually fulfilling scripture. He was forementioned, prophesied by Zechariah, and John actually was in the picture. I think it moved him to think that, man, that wasn't staged. We actually put him on the donkey. And I think what's going to happen for us in terms of Revelation, once we're in the story a little further, and I believe we are in the last days, but there's something yet to come, we will know in the moment, we'll be able to say, this is what that means. This is what was foretold, and it'll be absolutely clear. But it's more in the moment. On this side of it, it's hard to figure out. But when you're actually in it, it'll be a no-brainer. It'll be like, oh, well, that's so obvious now. It says it, no wonder. Joel prophesied about the pouring out of the Holy Spirit. And that was a game changer of a prophecy. Nothing quite like that. It was electric. People held on to that prophecy as the promise of God. But on the day of Pentecost, when that prophecy actually happened, it looked a little different. It looked different than probably what anyone was anticipating. And Peter stood up and said, this is that. This is what was foretold. He put it in the context. In the moment, he realized this is the fulfillment of something that God said hundreds of years ago. And I think we will have many of those experiences, or the people who are here when this finally comes about, they will say, oh, this is what the book of Revelation was talking about. This links up with Ezekiel. This links up with what was foretold in Daniel, and it all comes together. Jesus talked about this. I think we'll have those moments more, the clarity of those moments more when we're actually in it. For the people who become afraid of being in it, I remember hearing this story. I don't know now the source of it. I heard this as a new Christian. But I heard that there was a couple people who were about to be executed for their faith. They were about to become martyrs, and they were going to be burned at the stake. And they're waiting in the Colosseum prison. They're looking out and watching other people being burned at the stake. And while they're talking about it, they're saying to themselves, I wonder if there's grace for this. I mean, you're not feeling grace before you go, but in the moment, is there a special grace? Does God clothe you with something that where you don't feel the flames and you're feeling more of his glory than you're feeling the pain of the flame? And they made this little agreement between the two of them. They said, whoever goes first, whichever one of us goes first, let's have a signal to indicate that there's grace in the moment for what you're going through. They said that what you'll do, whoever goes out there, put one finger down to indicate to the rest of us who are waiting to be burned that there's grace in the moment. And so they took one of the prisoners, and they're all watching him being tied and the sticks being put up around him and the flame being lit. And they're watching his hand. They're watching for the signal to find out if there's grace in the moment. And the flames are going, and they're watching the man's hand, and they finally see the signal, only it's not one finger. He puts up two fingers. And I never forgot that. And I think what happens is we're looking at the end times, the wrath of God, this terrible judgment day, that all that leads up to the final judgment day, and we don't have grace for it, and we just think, well, I don't want to be in that, and I don't want my children to be in that. The people who are in it, who are in the story, will have grace for it. God will be with them. They'll feel his presence, his glory. They'll be so excited about the salvation that's taking place. Everything that God does equals salvation. They'll be so grateful to be part of a last big end time harvest. And so there's things that you will feel in the story that we're not feeling now as we anticipate the story. So that's what I want you to get. I don't want to take anything away from your anticipation, either by facts or by prophecies or by knowledge. I want you to be able to anticipate the end of the story, the end of all of humanity, the end of the world that God created, and that's my objective. That's what I want to achieve through this study over these next few weeks.